I'm James Taylor. Let's model this gun in Maya. So this is a hard surface object, meaning we want to end up with a lot of model detail. But we want to start out simple with just a basic block out. So I've created a cube, and now I want to try and capture the overall basic shape of my object before I start trying to add any detail. I'm going to extrude back from the existing face to just capture that handle shape. And you'll see that overall, my subdivisions are angled to match the general angle of the gun. So that front grip, the back grip, all the angles kind of flow along the same direction. That's what I've geared my subdivisions towards. Now I want to start cutting in that division between the top and the bottom body. So I'm going to use my split polygon or my multi-cut tool to just cut in and just try and match that division between the top and the bottom. So the stuff that I start cutting in now, for example, I'm using the cut faces tool to cut in a subdivision at the top. I know that these are going to be important features that will shape the whole model. That's why I'm working on them now. Otherwise, I want to still stick with broad strokes. So I'm just pulling up some verts to create the bottom of the barrel area. And you'll see that I delete verts where I don't need them so that I can make things easy to work with. Now you'll see I'm cutting in to define that same line again. And I've cut straight across and then I've cut down diagonally. And I'm just going to add a point to that diagonal line to create the curvature that I know that I'm going to need there. You'll see that I'm also adding subdivisions to create that ejection port area. So I'm basically outlining it to capture the overall shape. And I'm making sure that my geometry lines up cleanly in those areas. So I move my verts around, I squash them into flat lines, I merge them together. The goal is to keep my geometry nice and clean so that it's very simple to work with. Keeping our mesh organized is absolutely critical for hard surface, high resolution modeling. Now my cut faces and my multi-cut tools aren't the only ways to add geometry. I've used my extrude tool here to inset a face so that I can begin to define that empty area between the body and the handle. Now I'll move the back edge backwards so that it sits on the handle, and I'm just giving myself a little space to create the curvature for the grip. Now before I delete the face that I inset, I'm going to connect to the edges using my multi-cut tool just so I can define that angle at the bottom of the grip. Then I can grab the face, extrude it backwards, and I've got the area for the handle there. And you'll see I moved those points around. I'm just thinking ahead to when I need to smooth. And I'll use my cut faces again to create the curvature of the handle. We'll see that if I select some faces and then use the cut faces will only affect the selected area. So this is a good way of focusing and cutting in an area where we need more detail without affecting the rest of the mesh. So we've been focused entirely on the low res now using the multi-cut and the cut faces and the extrude. Now let's look at smoothing the mesh. So I'll start by using the smooth proxy by just hitting the 3 key. This lets us just preview the smooth without actually smoothing it. Now I need to use the crease tool. So the crease tool is used by selecting edges, and the crease tool allows us to keep parts of our smooth model basically unsmoothed. So the areas where I need to have sharp, hard corners, those are the edges that I crease. So you'll see that I'm grabbing edges and I'm using the crease tool by just middle mouse dragging it. And as I select my edges and I crease them, we see that they take on the shapes that we recognize from before. So we're starting to get more curvature, but at the same time, we're keeping the definition that we created on the low-res mesh. So smoothing definitely changes the shape of our object. We have to move verts around to capture the shape again. But creasing is really a critical aspect that's not easy to understand. For example, I have to crease this edge here to create the flat surface along the bottom of the gun. And in general, anywhere that we want a flat surface or we need a sharp corner, we're going to have to crease in more than one direction. So you'll see here, I'm going to merge this vert downwards, and then I'll play around with creasing all the edges in this area to get the kind of effect that I want. So the point is, if you're creasing to try and get a shape and you can't get it to work right, try creasing the edges around it to see if you can get the right flat shape or the curvature that you need. And in this example, I had to actually cut in new geometry to get the shape that I needed. All right, so onto the stock here. I'm going to start with some cylinders and use my cut faces tool to shape them. That'll be much quicker than trying to, say, rotate the cap into place. Then I'll just duplicate downwards and extrude from the top one downwards to create that crossbar between the two of them. And now that crossbar isn't the right shape, so I'll use my cut faces or my connect components tool to cut across. And I'll do that a few times until I end up with that curved shape that I need. And this is a really simple shape. We just want to remember that because machined objects are manufactured out of pieces, we want to try and construct our objects based on those same pieces. It makes the job a lot easier. So here's a little trick I like to use to mirror my object. I'm going to go to Edit, Duplicate Special, and I want to make sure that Instance is turned on, and I'm going to set the scale to -1 over the axis that I want to flip it on. So in this case, it's the Z-axis to flip it across, and I'll get a mirrored version of my object that will update whenever my original object is changed. So this makes it very handy to see the entire object at one time and to make corrections for volume and stuff like that. Okay, so up to this point, I've been using smooth proxy and just turning smoothing on and off. At a certain point, we have to permanently smooth. So mesh, smooth, and we smooth so that we can use the extra geometry that's created, the extra rows and verts, to create finer level detail. But we'll have a lot of extra geometry in there, and in a lot of cases, we don't need it. So I can select edges that I don't need and use the Delete Edge tool to get rid of these extra rows. And these extra rows get in the way. They make it harder to work with my mesh. So I want to optimize my object as much as possible by getting rid of rows that I don't need and keeping only the rows that I do need. So I'll use Collapse or Delete Edge or Delete Vert to get rid of that geometry. And again, the goal is a simple mesh that's easy to work with. Now, even after I've smoothed, I'll still use smooth proxy because my mesh is still relatively low res. And I'll use that extra geometry that's been built in to start to sharply define shape. So like the area around this ejection port. Now, as we smooth, we'll note that concentrating verts in certain areas will create sharper detail for us. So for example, by stacking the verts up in this area, I can control the curvature in this region more effectively than I could otherwise. One problem that smoothing can cause is weird overlapping edges like these. And in this case, we actually need to twist the edge around by using our flip/spin edge tool so that we're connecting it to a different point so that we get much smoother flowing geometry. So this has been the block-in step, and our general goal here is just to represent the overall shape of our object. Our next step is to start to add more and more fine level detail. That's what the next video will cover. All right, I'm James Taylor. Thanks for watching.